So you want to be a translator? Well, hope you like feeling unappreciated. Just kidding. This job is going to give you lots of satisfaction. Or will it? I've been working in different roles in the translation industry for the past 7 years, and my main pair of languages is Polish and Chinese, and I cannot wait to tell you everything about it. So let me start with the bad news. The hardest part of the job is that you are literally invisible. There is even a concept in translation studies called translators' invisibility. The creator of this theory is Lawrence Venuti, and here's a whole book about it. When you are invisible as a translator, it basically means that you shouldn't make your presence known. Make your translation feel exactly like the original. And there are many theories underlying that concept, but whatever you do, do not leave any evidence. Essentially, be a ninja with words. When you translate a book, your name will not appear on the cover. When you localize a game or create subtitles for the movie, it is likely that your agency will be credited for it and not you specifically. Of course, nowadays there are different websites where you can claim your works, you can add it to your LinkedIn profile, and you can add it to your CV, but do you seriously think that somebody would care enough to check it? This issue is discussed a lot with the Nobel Prize in Literature. Should the writer take all the credit for the success of their work? Where is the Nobel Prize in translation? As a localization specialist, I localized countless apps, UIs for countless products, and my name appears absolutely freaking nowhere. The only way I am ever contacted about the contents I localized is when there is a problem. If your translation is great, nobody will praise you for it. Actually, there is a way in localization quality assurance, or LQA for short, to give praise to others for their translation or receive praise yourself. But this is only to downgrade the severity of your f**ks. The only way you get praise for your work is in the context of criticizing it. And get ready to be criticized a lot. Translation is a job that everybody thinks they can do better than you. Anybody who speaks two languages thinks they are a translator. This is a complete bullshit. After I got my degree in translation and interpreting, or MTI, I experienced something that could only be described as translation identity crisis. At my first workplace, we've had people from all kinds of different backgrounds, marketing experts, engineers, and so on, doing translation. I suddenly felt like all the effort that I've put in my degree has been completely wasted. The truth is, you don't need a whole degree in translation to be a translator, but it does give you a unique set of skills for the job. And on top of everything, it is just a tiring job. You just cannot slip. If you slip, it will be on you. Your brain is on the lookout around the clock because everything you read and see can influence your output. And the time of the day that you actually spend working, you have to pay a lot of attention to what you do. Imagine for a second that you're translating an order for purchase. You've translated a number of items incorrectly. Now there is one more zero in there. Your company is suddenly paying 10 times what they thought they would be paying. And who is to blame for that? Interpreting is even harder, and I will forever admire anyone who is able to work as an interpreter. As one of my professors used to say in the university, interpreting is the fastest way to lose weight because you get stressed and you sweat so much. But this is a story for another day. Oh, you're still here. Okay, let's get down to business. So let me tell you about the tools and qualifications that you will need as a translator. First of all, you need to know at least two languages. Bilingual kids will have unfair advantage here, and it will make me forever jealous. But I am not bilingual by any sense of this word, and I am still able to do the job perfectly well. This is because my main focus is my native language. As a native speaker, you probably think that you are an expert in your language already. Probably know it really well. It's not that hard, right? Imagine you're working as a language specialist in an international company with people from all around the world. You're the only representative of your country there, and you're translating UI for a smart band like this. The screen is really tiny and there's simply no space for unnecessary things. Suddenly you have to reduce a full sentence to two words to fit them on the screen, and you need to explain your choice to the developers. The developers who don't speak your language and they care very little about things like grammar. Anything that you cannot explain to the non-natives of your language is a potential liability. Seriously, I've been in situations where I have to explain that grammar even exists. For example, a Chinese sentence doesn't require a subject, which is where a lot of foreigners make mistakes. But European languages mostly need a subject. So when I'm asking the client who is doing the action in the sentence, they don't even understand why I need that information.
Okay, this is where you want to get to, right?
That is the question.
Okay, so first we need to make sure that they understand what a question is. Okay, the nature of a request for information along with the response. Then we need to clarify the difference between a specific you and a collective you, because we don't want to know why Joe Alien is here. We want to know why they all landed. And purpose requires an understanding of intent. We need to find out, do they make conscious choices or is their motivation so instinctive that they don't understand a why question at all? And biggest of all, we need to have enough vocabulary with them that we understand their answer.
Just translate it as it is. Prepare to hear that a lot. And be prepared for your professionalism to ruin all kinds of entertainment for you. You will start nitpicking at your friend's grammar. You will see UX issues in every game. Texts in the apps that could have been edited down. Sometimes the urge to fix stuff is really stronger than me. On the other hand, you also have to be an expert in your culture. You need to know what is offensive, what can be misinterpreted, what can be misunderstood. Depending on the situation, you need to be as precise or as vague as possible. And you need to be able to explain why, because remember, people will be coming for you. This is to say, language is not the only thing that you need to know, because the culture is equally important.
You don't put ginger on the fish. It's to clear the palate between pieces, not drown it out. And it is already precisely sauced. Doesn't need a soy bath.
Chill out, Mr. Miyagi.
No. I won't, you heathens. This man is an artist. He had to spend 10 years learning how to make the tamago. The egg. The egg!
Second thing you need is expertise in the industry tools, depending on where you work and which languages you work with. Your job will likely require some kind of computer-aided translation software, or CAT for short. And when I was at the university, I used to look down on these a lot, because I wanted to be a literary translator, and literature is art. So how can you depend on machines when translating art? Which is true to some extent, AI is not coming for your job. But obviously my attitude was very close-minded, because CAT tools don't do the job for you, they just make it easier. And boy, you need it to be easier, because during work you simply do not have the brain space to be occupied with unnecessary stuff like consistency or typos. These things can easily be resolved with the right software. Obviously, you will also need a good dictionary. Contrary to the popular opinion, translators are not walking, talking dictionaries.
The translator's not making a whole lot of sense to him, sir. He's getting frustrated. I think he's running out of patience, Captain.
Then forget the translator. Do it yourself.
Do what myself?
Talk to him.
That's impossible, sir. I haven't even learned their basic conjugations.
Talk to him, Hoshi. It doesn't have to be perfect.
You don't understand. I don't even know how to say pump. I'll get it all wrong. It'll just make things worse.
Things can't get much worse.
So a good dictionary is one that gives you an extensive explanation of the meaning of the word, so you can be sure that you are using it in the right context. And for the same reason, you also want one that gives you a lot of synonyms. You can also find a corpus for your language to check how often a word is used in a given context. Another useful tool is Translators Community, and you can find those on any social media platform. I especially liked LinkedIn for this because it really lets you connect to people from all over the world, speaking all different languages and coming from all different sorts of backgrounds. And knowing the perspective and the difficulties of different language groups when working in a multilingual team really helps you to solve issues collectively and more efficiently. This is also why I advise people who want to work with localization to learn languages with the mindset of deciphering them rather than learning them fluently. Depending on the language pairs that you want to work with, you will also find different translation forums that will help you improve. Most notable international forum for translators is Prozy. Also, be mindful of the areas that you are interested in and that you want to improve in, because there are tons of webinars available online. So when you have all that, the third thing that you need as a translator are research skills. As translators, we don't need to be experts in every field. Of course, it's great if you feel strong in one subject and can confidently translate specialized texts. That knowledge is worth tons. Like, I am pretty confident about my microcopy because I spent years translating Chinese mobile games into Polish. But if you'd asked me to translate a medical text, I would need a ton of research to go through that.
These markings, what do you think, decorative or linguistic?
You're asking me.
Don't study linguistics if you don't want people to ask you questions about it.
Okay.
I obviously cannot become a doctor or a chemist or an engineer in a few hours. If you don't have expertise in a given field, you really need your research skills to be on point. And that means you need to know what you're looking for and where to look for it. And the problem with our times is that a lot of information that you find online is downright wrong. So not every source is as reliable as it may seem. So be aware of that. The last thing that I want to mention here, although there are many more things to be discussed, is that every translator should have some patience. I definitely do not have much myself, but I do have some. My wonderful coworker, who used to work in a more research-related position, once told me that she really appreciates our job because it can give you instant gratification. Depending on the subject matter, a translation project can be finished in as little as a few hours. But some translation projects can even take years. And usually the client, be it a person, a company, or an organization, we'll try to get you to hurry up. Some organizational skills are really good to have, by the way, because at the end of the day, you are the only one who really understands your own strengths and weaknesses and who really knows how much workload you can accept. So, back to the topic. The patience I'm talking about is about the time and work organization, but also about dealing with other people. Many projects will require you to work with a client or with a third party where you do research as you go. In many cases, you won't be able to finish a project unless you get some additional info. And having to depend on other people for that really makes me furious. So, all in all, without going into too much detail about why I chose this job for myself, and despite all the drawbacks and the obstacles that I've listed, I really love this job. It gives me an opportunity to work with all kinds of languages wherever I am in the world, without any judgment for the way I look and without the dress code. And I still get a lot of satisfaction from it, despite being invisible. And I cannot imagine myself doing anything else. So if you have any questions or anything else to add, scroll down to the comment section and let me know.